Drugs have been with us for a long time. It's a problem we haven't figured out how to resolve yet. Unfortunately, it has ruined a lot of athletes' careers. As the great wrestler Scott Hall once said, "I can't tell you not to drink and do drugs. They're fun. It's fun. They work. But what sucks is when you want to quit and you can." From NBA, the most notable example probably is Len Bias. His career in the NBA never started as drugs ultimately killed him right after he was drafted into the league. The athlete I want to talk about today lost his promising career because of drugs. Hey guys, Purple Prince here, and today we're looking at the career of Michael Ray Richardson. The 6'5", 190-pound guard played college ball at the University of Montana. As a freshman, Richardson averaged 7.5 points and 3.6 rebounds, and from that period on, it was all about improvements. Richardson made a major jump in his sophomore season, averaging 18.2 points and 6.3 rebounds, and by his last season at University of Montana, he was already averaging 24.2 points and 6.9 rebounds. In total, during his 4 years in college, Richardson averaged 17.1 points, 6.3 rebounds, and 3.7 assists on 49% shooting. In the 1978 NBA draft, the New York Knicks took him with the 4th overall pick, and right away he was billed as the next Walt Frazier. Although it seemed funny at the time, he really wasn't far off. He had a silent rookie season as he was on the court for just 16.9 minutes per game and averaged 6.5 points, 3 assists, and 3.2 rebounds, but from that point on, he was great. Unfortunately, 1978 was also the first time he experimented with cocaine. On court though, in his just second season, Richardson led the league in assists and steals, setting the Knicks franchise record in both categories. He played all 82 games and averaged 15.3 points, 10.1 assists, 3.2 steals, and 6.6 rebounds. He recorded 18 triple-doubles. He made the NBA All-Star team. He really did it all, on and off the court. Never mind his off-court issues, for the next two seasons Richardson would make All-Star teams and continue his strong performances. With his strong play, he became the face of the league. By 1982 though, his problems were starting to really impact his game. At the beginning of the 1982-83 season, Richardson was traded to the Golden State Warriors for Bernard King. That was a dark period in his life. "While my agent was trying to squeeze more money out of the Warriors," says Richardson, "I stayed in New York smoking my brains out, running the streets at night, hanging with all of the city's sports heroes one night, then hanging out with the worst kind of street scum the next night. The worst part was that I was thinking everything was cool. I wasn't an addict. I was just having myself a good time. When we finally got the deal done with Golden State, I went out there and sprained my ankle the first day I practiced. So now, I was holed up and all strung out in a Holiday Inn. Women were bringing me drugs and food and I was totally fucked up. This was the low point in my life so far." So he was hanging out with the wrong people in the wrong places. Richardson and his wife divorced. Richardson played just 33 games for the Warriors before being traded again, this time to the New Jersey Nets. In New Jersey, his problems escalated, and he even was waived by the Nets. By December 1983, Richardson had been to 3 drug clinics in a 5-month span. But he still had so much talent, and the Nets did bring him back, which proved to be the right move, as in 1984, Richardson led the Nets to a shocking first-round playoff upset over the defending champions, the Philadelphia 76ers. In the 5th game of the first round, Richardson had 24 points and 6 steals. Everything was great. Richardson signed a new 4-year, $3 million deal with the Nets. He participated in an NBA anti-drug video called Cocaine Drain, and according to team officials, passed every one of the weekly drug tests. For a while, it seemed that this will be a feel-good story. Richardson had overcome his cocaine problems. He had his 4th All-Star season in 1985, when he averaged 20.1 points, 8.2 assists, 5.6 rebounds, and 3 steals. His life was rolling. The dream ended soon though, as on December 27, 1985, Richardson went to a team Christmas party, after which he went to a bar for a few drinks with Daryl Dawkins and Bobby Kadich. After that, he went missing for a couple of days. Nobody, not even his wife, knew where he had gone, until a couple of days later when Richardson called his agent Charles Granham and admitted that he messed up once again. It was so sad, said Grenham, because he had told me so many times, I'll never go back on drugs, never. Yet he did. And on February 25, 1986, Richardson tested positive for cocaine for a third time, becoming the first player to get banned under the NBA's anti-drug program. All of us will rationally say that no one would choose to jeopardize his career for the sake of having fun getting high, Grenham said. Michael Ray has tried hard to stay clean, and he was for a year. It's a disease. He participated in a drug prevention film. All the players have seen and explained his problem. Now people say to me, he didn't even try to keep his word. I've known Michael closely for 3 years, and I don't see how people can characterize him as a bad person. Maybe a person with bad judgment. Once talented NBA player was now in debt, unemployed, banned from NBA, and under investigation. He would automatically regain the right to play in the NBA in 1988 if he remained clean, but he never did step foot on an NBA court again. Michael Ray Richardson finished his NBA career with 556 games played, an average of 14.8 points, 7 assists, 5.5 rebounds, and 2.6 steals. After Richardson was banned from the NBA, he played a couple of seasons in the United States Basketball League and CBA. In 1988, he went to Europe and signed a contract to play with Bologna in Italy. He won two Italian Cups and the 1990 FIBA European Cup while being the top scorer. He played for 8 more teams in Europe and continued his basketball career as a player all the way up to when he was already 46 years old. He came back to North America in 2003 and was a community ambassador for the Denver Nuggets. After that, Richardson worked as a coach for multiple teams for about 10 years. As a coach, he became a two-time CBA champion, two-time NBL Canada champion, and two-time NBL Coach of the Year. Larry Bird once called him the best player on the planet. Magic Johnson saw a lot of Richardson in his own game. Isaiah Thomas said that Richardson was the one player he was scared of. That's how talented was Michael Sugar Ray Richardson. Now, as recent as 2015, he just hoped he can return to the NBA someday. All I want is a shot, an assistant's role, a scouting position, anything where I can help and develop players at the NBA level. If the NBA wants a winner, they need to come hire me. Like all my players in the minor leagues, they'd love to play in the NBA. I'm no different than them. I'd love to coach in the NBA. I fulfilled my dream as a player. I've not fulfilled it as a coach. Will I ever get that opportunity? I don't know. Thanks for watching the video, guys. Do you think Michael Ray Richardson was on a path to greatness and maybe even the Basketball Hall of Fame? Can you name other players with drug problems that ultimately ruined their careers? Please express yourself in the comment section. Like the video and share it with your friends. Also, don't forget to subscribe to my YouTube channel, as that really motivates me to be more active. Thanks. This was Purple Princh, and I'm out. I'm in love with the coco. I'm in love with the coco. I got it for the Lolo. I'm in love with the coco. I'm in love with the coco. I'm in love with the coco.